Hi everyone and welcome back. How's everyone doing out there? Who all is still getting outside for an easy ride, and who have headed indoors waiting until everything blows over outside? Today I'm going to be covering the much requested CBF suspension design of the 165mm Revel Rail. Worldwide Cyclery has been a big proponent of this brand, and many have asked whether it's just good marketing or if this truly is a unique design with excellent physics backing it. Along with the normal parameters I cover in all my suspension videos, I'm also going to be providing a nice little animation to make it easier to understand the core principle of the CBF design. Let me start by looking at the anti-rise for the Revel Rail. In general, you want the anti-rise to counteract the forward weight shift of the rider that occurs under braking, but there's a trade-off. Too much anti-rise will compress the suspension a lot under braking, and you'll end up with a less active, firmer feeling suspension. Too little, and you'll have a very active suspension, but the bike will be able to pitch forward easily, which can be very bad on steep descents. For the rail, the anti-rise starts around 90% and decreases almost linearly to around 60% at full travel. In my opinion, this is a really good amount of anti-rise that strikes the balance between level braking and an active suspension. As part of the analysis of anti-rise, I'm going to compare it to a theoretical single pivot bike where the pivot is located at the very top of the front chainring. You'll see why I do this in a moment. In this case, the anti-rise would linearly decrease from just above 100% to just below 70%. Overall, this is slightly higher and will cause the suspension to compress slightly more when rear braking, resulting in what is called brake jack. Multi-link suspensions such as the CBF seek to improve on this by decoupling the braking forces from the main swing arm, moving the braking IC forward and reducing the anti-rise slightly. It's at this point that I should explain the main idea behind the CBF, and that is focusing on the center of curvature location rather than the instantaneous center when looking at the acceleration forces. To which you're probably staring blankly at your screen saying, "Huh?" Stick with me on this one for a few moments and I'll try to make it a little bit less engineery. Imagine I had a stick that was nailed to a board. If I applied a force at the end of the stick directed through the nail, the stick wouldn't move or rotate. If I now redirected the forces such that it was above or below the nail, then the stick would rotate accordingly around the pivot nail. Now imagine I expanded the stick to be pie-shaped and applied a force horizontally. The pie would still rotate. But if I redirected this force through the pivot nail, the pie would again cease to rotate or move. This is the key point to the CBF, except replace the nail with the center of curvature, replace the pie with the arc created between the top of the chainring and the rear axle as it moves through its travel, and the force applied is as a result of the chain pull during acceleration. By keeping the chain force acting through the center of curvature, or nail, and perpendicular to the movement of the rear axle, the chain doesn't pull the swing arm, or stick, either up or down, and causes the suspension to be fully decoupled from the chain forces. At this point, you're probably saying to yourself, isn't this just a single pivot design? Yes, it absolutely is, which is why I included the single pivot analysis with anti-rise. For the most part, the CBF design during acceleration acts like a single pivot. The CBF does take it a step further and has the center of curvature move very slightly around the top of the chainring, so the chain forces always go through the CC as the suspension compresses. It is also largely gear independent, as the distance change at the front chainring between being in the largest and the smallest gear is very slight. Despite this slight CC movement, overall the suspension design still acts effectively like a single pivot without actually being a single pivot. So why not just use a single pivot instead of all the complicated links? You'll have to stick around for my summary to find out why. After all this talk about center of curvature, you might be wondering what it actually is and how it's calculated. It's relatively simple to identify if you already have the instantaneous center. If I draw a line between the rear axle and IC at various points throughout the travel, the intersection between two subsequent axle IC lines is the center of curvature. It is the effective rotation point that is created when both sides of the line are moving in opposite directions. As a result, the center of curvature line always lies along the line one uses to calculate anti-squat, and doesn't change the anti-squat analysis at all. Speaking of anti-squat, for the rail, the anti-squat decreases from around 110% to around 70%, depending on which gear you're in. A smaller gear will result in higher anti-squat for the suspension design. There might be some of you that, based on the CBF summary I just gave, might be surprised to see that the anti-squat goes so low. The key thing to remember is that anti-squat is the resistance of the suspension to compression due to rider weight transfer rearward during acceleration. So while the pedaling is efficient for the rail, in that the chain forces alone won't seek to compress or extend the suspension, there will still be a rider weight transfer rearward due to inertia. This is likely to result in some suspension compression or bob, as those same chain forces don't seek to extend the suspension at all to counteract the weight transfer. Looking now at the leverage ratio and progressivity of the suspension design, one will notice a slightly progressive response during the first 50% of the travel, followed by a largely linear response. Comparing this to the leverage ratios of other long travel bikes that I've looked at, including the Ransom, Megatower, Enduro, and Capra, the more linear nature of the response becomes more evident. As a result of this leverage ratio, you're still going to get some small bump compliance improvement during the first part of the travel, but the end stroke is going to rely on the shock to provide the bottom-out support. Finally, as always, we'll conclude the analysis by looking at the wheel path and chain growth. Because the CBF design has a very centralized center of curvature near the top of the chainring and acts like a single pivot, it shouldn't come as too much of a surprise that the wheel path mimics that of a single pivot. It starts slightly rearward before following a nice arc around the center of curvature. Nothing out of the ordinary compared to similar bikes of this category. In terms of chain growth, the Revel Rail has a growth of 25.6 mm or around 6%, which is about what I'd expect for a longer travel enduro bike and will result in pedal kickback, especially during technical climbs. For comparison, the Scott Ransom has a 6.3% growth, the Megatower is at 5.2, and the Enduro is up at 6.8. Time to summarize what I've learned from analyzing the Revel Rail. Firstly, the anti-rise is high enough to keep the bike mostly level during rear braking, but not so high as to prevent the suspension from being active. Secondly, although the suspension design is very efficient in terms of converting pedaling forces to wheel movement without affecting the suspension, it does have anti-squat values that drop to below 100%, meaning that the weight transfer of the rider during acceleration will still likely result in a little pedal bub at mid-travel, for instance. But overall, the rail will still be a good pedaler. Thirdly, the leverage ratio is not hugely progressive compared to some bikes, due to its more linear second half, resulting in bottom-out prevention relying more on the shock. Fourth, there's nothing notable with the wheel path or chain growth compared to other bikes in this category. In light of these previous 4 points, I can now address why Revel didn't just use a single pivot design if several parameters mimic that of a single pivot. Not only does the CBF cause a slight reduction in anti-rise compared to a single pivot, leading to a slightly more active suspension, the designers would have had to use linkages anyways to obtain the leverage curve that they were looking for, so it just makes sense to use the linkages in the overall suspension design. Based on all this, is the CBF as awesome as the marketing claims it to be? Well, I will agree that they're onto something. Active but level braking, efficient pedaler but without excessive chain growth, and not hugely progressive, but enough that with a few volume spacers you could tweak it to be sufficiently progressive. Claiming CBF is revolutionary and the perfect bike for everyone might be a stretch, but it does strike an excellent balance between all these parameters. Thanks for joining me again this week. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to the channel and like the video to let me know that you like what I'm doing on the channel. And remember, if you want to be a part of the recurring polls to help me decide which bike to look at next, make sure to head over to my Patreon page using the link down below. Until next time, stay safe!